of very low cost and can work in continuous mode, and those do not require any external pump in order to put wastewater into the reactor. Our first reactor is auto-circulate bioelectrochemical reactor. It is auto-server. It is a continuous power-free auto reactor. It eliminates the need of external agitation and power requirement. Therefore, it is a kind of net power generator rather than net neutral or net negative power system. Usually what happens, if you are generating power out of natural fuel cell, and if you are using pump to put energy into the pump and energy to put wastewater into the system, it means you are spending more energy rather than generating it. But this system is free out of all those limitations. In our work, this auto server was constructed using 10 liter of rectangular plastic container and compartmented into one central anode system and two peripheral cathode system. Two cathode system are of 2.5 liter, while a main anode was of 5 liter. Anode was a kind of packed bed system. Anode was filled with activated carbon coated stones, and then it was allowed to immobilize electricity and biofilm over their packed bed. In cathode chamber, specifically designed cathode plates were added, and those were added with some catalyst and cathode material so that wastewater can move to cathode and can be treated. This is the major design. Here you can say that wastewater can enter from here. If you put this wastewater inlet from any factory's outlet, then wastewater will enter here and it will go to the anode system and it will treat anaerobically in the anode chamber. And then what would happen? This will come out of those outlets to the cathode chamber. And as cathodes are aerobic system, the wastewater will treat aerobically as well. So in the same reactor, wastewater will treat anaerobically as well as aerobically. And there is no need to circulate wastewater. It will circulate via gravitational flow. Wastewater will come from here, it will circulate here, and it will go from here, and it will go from specially designed those baffles. And from here it will come out, from here it will come out. What is the salient feature of this reactor? It has low HRT. As packed bed, our arrangement is available in the anode. So more microbial reaction is possible in the anode chamber in the less time, so HRT is less. Increase in VSS, COD, and BOD reduction rate. If HRT is less, if biofilm is more efficient, if it is treating in more rate, then your COD, BOD, and VSS removal rate will certainly be high. Scale-up is more, even scale-up at high level is possible. You can see from this design that if you will scale this reactor at even 50 liter, 100 liter, 1000 liter, you need not to make any other part. You simply need to enlarge it, and packed bed will be there. And if packed bed will be there, the efficiency loss will be very less, and scaling up will be very easy. It is a very suitable design for a wide variety of wastewater, and liquid loading rate is also increased here because the microbial film volume and surface area ratio is far higher. Continuous mixing of wastewater by liquid motion. There is no need of external pump here. It is energy efficient. And because of gravity time flow in the head, it requires very minimal maintenance because you can see there's very less movable part. Now, multi-criteria microbial fuel cell. Multi-criteria microbial fuel cell was developed to accomplish wastewater disinfection after its chemical route reduction. Actually, what happens in many wastewater treatment plants, there is a wastewater which is generated which is required to be disinfected. It has lot and lot of pathogenic microorganisms. So in our this design, we have generated a system there disinfection also happened with the cathodic anhydride reaction. Here wastewater enters from this area and it moves from this area to this area via different plates. You can see arrow, there is arrow. This is the direction of flow of the fluid. And after treatment in the anaerobic chamber, it moves toward cathodic chamber and it goes on the cathodic plates. When it goes on the cathodic plate, there is a disinfectant which is doped on the cathodic plate and it moves towards the outlet point. When it moves towards the outlet point, multiple work happens. Chemical load reduction, COD reduction, and wastewater, other BOD reduction, BSS reduction, electricity generation, as well as wastewater disinfection. Wastewater disinfection is needed in many industries and it is not allowed to dispose your wastewater without disinfection, like swine industry, animal wastewater, medical wastewater. So such kind of reactor is very much useful in those kind of area. And it is also useful in those slaughterhouse area, many area of the India, like nearby Meerut and nearby Unnao, Kanpur. Those are, there are tannery, small tanneries in the community. So such kind of reactors are good there because those tanneries and those tanneries generate lot of pathogenic wastewater. Salient feature of microbial multi-criteria microbial fuel cell, it is also very compact and easy design. Here you can see that no movable part. Wastewater runs here and wastewater come to the cathode point and wastewater comes out of cathode point, no movable part. So if there is no movable part, it can run up to long time. It does not require lot of maintenance and it can be easily scale up. Here also continuous mixing of wastewater by using liquid motion. Here you can see that wastewater is mixed with the help of gravitational flow as well as liquid force mixing. No external pump is needed because here reactor content is continuously mixing and it is continuously in contact with the reaction plates. So entire content of the reactor is mixed thoroughly. Same reactor generates electricity, reduces chemical load and kills microorganisms. So it means it performs multiple actions. It is very energy efficient because no external pump is needed. And serpentine and slopy flow is used instead of external pump. And also there is provision to make auto aeration of the cathode chamber. Here you can see there are small gaps. These small gaps are for the aeration. So if the aeration is there in the cathode chamber, it means you need not to apply external aeration also. It means your reactor is more energy efficient. Elimination of choking and clogging, there is no movable part. There is a simple system. There is no packed bed like earlier reactor. In earlier reactor, there was a packed bed. So after some time, there was needed, there was some cleaning of the packed bed is needed. But in this reactor system, there is no cleaning is required. System is very much efficient for long-term operation with very minimal maintenance. And now trickling bioelectrochemical reactor trick word. Trickling is more simpler configuration of auto server. Our first reactor, which I shown you here, trickling filter was developed by incorporating a separator from reactor assembly comprising a 2.5 centimeter thick ceramic pipe. Here also a packed bed reactor system is there. Plurality of anodes were packed in reactor tank and each anode comprised plastic wall covered by conductive paint and then it was coated with activated carbon and it was packed. Here, like auto server, we eliminated from the auto server, there is some advancement. We eliminated aqueous cathode system. Aqueous cathode has lot of limitations because the availability of oxygen in the water is very much limited than the availability of water oxygen in the air. So here, cathode is air system, or you can say aerobic cathode is there. Here you can say, you can see that it is a packed bed system. Here, anode is a kind of packed bed, while cathode is the air system. It is exposed to air. Here, wastewater enters from lower side. Wastewater enters from lower side, and with help of fluid forward feed, it comes upper side like this, like this, like this. And that's why it is called trickling, reverse trickling air, bioelectrochemical reactor. Air trickling is there, but it is in reverse manner. So wastewater flow from this direction to this direction, and after treatment is comes out of from this direction. And this is a sampling port. You can sample whenever you want. From here, it comes out, and this reactor has far better efficiency than autocirculate reactor, because here your cathode is aerobic. However, in this reactor, only anaerobic wastewater treatment happens, while in autoserver, aerobic and aerobic both kind of wastewater treatment happen. The specialized features of TrickWer, it is constructed and optimized to reduce its cost. It is constructed with very low cost materials, so it can be afforded by any small industry, even by a small family also. So it is a very cost effective system. Due to its cylindrical design, it can be easily installed in house, small industry and organization, like a small canteen, etc., near waste outlet. It has very low maintenance cost and can operate without any cost up to several months, because it has even less movable part than auto server. So it has very low cost in the maintenance. And in our study, we found that 6 months or after 7 months, we require little bit maintenance. And maintenance what? We need to clean the anode packed bed. By minor advancement in its structure, the system could offer wastewater disinfectant and outer point. At outer point, if you will pack some disinfectant materials bed, then wastewater disinfection can also happen after the wastewater treatment. So this is all about my work. And thank you. I ask participants to ask some questions.
अभिलाषा मैम,
यस,
एक चीज जानना था आपसे. ये लास्ट में आपने जो ट्रिक पीआर वाला जो बताया ना. हेलो,
हाँ जी बताएं.
ये आपने जो लास्ट में जो बताया ना ट्रिक बीईआर, सबसे सिंपल मैकेनिज्म है ये, आपकी जानकारी में कहाँ इम्प्लीमेंट हो रहा है, थोड़ा यदि बता सकें.
ये हमने बात की है हमारे कॉलेज की, हम अपनी यूनिवर्सिटी कैंटीन में इसको लगाने की सोच रहे हैं. साथ ही में यहाँ पास में एक गांव है, हमारी यूनिवर्सिटी का कम्युनिटी कनेक्ट प्रोग्राम है, तो हमने पास में एक प्रधान जी हैं, उनसे बात किया है. वी आर नॉट डिस्क्लोजिंग द नेम ऑफ विलेज बिकॉज अभी हमारे क्लियरेंस नहीं हुए हैं. उन्होंने कहा है कि हम इसको अपने यहाँ पर लगवाएंगे अपने प्राइमरी स्कूल में. उनके प्राइमरी स्कूल में जब ये लगेगा तो हम इसकी इफिशियंसी चेक कर लेंगे कि इसकी इफिशियंसी कैसी है. ये और रिएक्टर से इसलिए बेटर है सर कि ये थोड़ी सी इलेक्ट्रिसिटी भी जनरेट करेगा. आपका वहाँ के अगर हम प्राइमरी स्कूल में बच्चे खाना वाना भी खाते हैं, वहाँ पे मिड डे मील भी बनता है, और वहाँ पर टॉयलेट्स भी हैं, वहाँ पर वेस्ट जनरेट होता है, वेस्ट वाटर जनरेट होता है. दैट वेस्ट वाटर विल बी ट्रीटेड एंड small amount of electricity will be generated, especially the electricity will be generated to light the toilet, etc. So, एक तो wastewater treatment की cost खत्म हो जाएगी, और उसके बाद में wastewater से कुछ ना कुछ electricity भी generate होगी. हम इसको बहुत जल्दी commercialize कर देंगे. ये अभी laboratory में pilot scale plant बन चुका है, और इसका जो funding हुआ है वो DST से हुआ है.
छोटा सा request है आपसे, जब ये implementation हो जाए मैडम, डॉक्यूमेंटेशन जरूर करवाइएगा, क्योंकि ऐसे छोटी छोटी जो सक्सेस स्टोरीज हैं हमारी कंट्री में, एल्सवेयर इसको रेप्लिकेट किया जा सकेगा उसके बाद, है ना. मतलब अदरवाइज क्या होता है, साइलोज में ये छोटी छोटी सक्सेस स्टोरीज दब के रह जाती हैं. तो आपसे ये रिक्वेस्ट है. थैंक यू
सो मच. थैंक यू. एनी क्वेश्चन?
इनका कोई लाइफ साइकिल होता है मैडम इन सेल्स का?
फ्यूल सेल्स का लाइफ साइकिल कंपैरेटिवली बैटरीज बहुत ज्यादा होता है। बैटरी में क्या है कि आपको बार बार चार्ज और रिचार्ज करना पड़ता है। बैटरी एक बार चार्ज कर ली फिर उसके बाद डिस्चार्ज हो जाती है। इसमें आपकी चार्जिंग ही वेस्ट वाटर है। अगर आपका वेस्ट वाटर 20 साल जाया जाएगा तो ये 20 साल तक काम करती रहेगी। आपको बस 5 महीने 6 महीने बाद थोड़ा सा इसको सफाई करनी होगी और कुछ भी नहीं करना है। आपने एक बार जो इंस्टॉल कर दिया रिएक्टर, वो रिएक्टर के इंस्टॉलमेंट में जो खर्चा हुआ वो हुआ, उसके बाद में इसका कोई भी अतिरिक्त खर्चा नहीं होता है। एंड दिस इज वन मेजर प्लस पॉइंट ऑफ सच काइंड ऑफ रिएक्टर्स।
थैंक यू मैडम,
थैंक यू सो मच मैम फॉर योर वैल्यूएबल वर्ड्स एंड शेयरिंग आवर नॉलेज टू द आवर पार्टिसिपेंट्स। वी डू हैव लॉट ऑफ क्वेश्चंस बट बिकॉज़ ऑफ टाइम कंस्ट्रेंट आई एम ओनली एबल टू टेक अ कपल ऑफ क्वेश्चंस। I would like to ask you why microbial fuel cells are not fully applicable as large scale wastewater treatment system.
Thank you for your question. Microbial fuel cells have all potential to be applied on large scale system. First of all, public acceptance. India mein jo cheez popular ho gayi, jo cheez ek baar popular ho gayi, wo ho jati hai. It takes lot of time to adopt new system.
Yes, ma'am.
लोगों ने टिकटॉक यूज कर लिया, अब इट टेक्स लॉट ऑफ टाइम टू कम टू अनदर प्लेटफॉर्म। सो माइक्रोबियल फ्यूल सेल्स हैव पोटेंशियल बट पब्लिक एक्सेप्टेंस इज डिफिकल्ट। सेकंड, माइक्रोबियल फ्यूल सेल्स एज दोज हैव एनोड एंड कैथोड सिस्टम, देयर इज सम लिमिटेशन ऑफ परफॉर्मेंस एट एनोड एज वेल एज एट कैथोड। वेस्ट वाटर ट्रीटमेंट कैपेसिटी इज 100% व्हेन यू स्केल अप टू 1000 लीटर 2000 लीटर इवन 5000 लीटर, but electricity generation it restricts somehow. So problem kya hoti hai ki agar aap large scale pe iska kaam kar rahe hain, if you are working on large scale then wastewater treatment happens but electricity generation does not happens. Okay. Electricity generation does not happen up to that level. That's why there are some limitations. Otherwise, micro fuel cells are gaining reputation and soon those will be in market in full capacity.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much. Ma'am, next question I would like to ask you that what are the major features of MFCs, microbial fuel cells?
Microbial fuel cells have lot of good features than aerobic wastewater treatment plants. You can see aerobic wastewater treatment plants in Agra, in Kanpur, and any major city waste treatment plant WTP. In major city, those are there. See, lot of power is required to treat wastewater. While in microbial fuel cell, as those are anaerobic system, those does not require any power in the aeration. Also, anaerobic wastewater treatments generate more energy than aerobic wastewater treatment. Also, microbial fuel cells are very high efficiency devices because they directly convert wastewater into the wastewater's energy into the electricity. While in biogas plant like anaerobic digester, what happens that anaerobic digester generates biogas. Then you have to use that in the heat and or something, or by a heat you generate into the you develop into the electricity. So at every point there is a specific energy loss. While in microbial fuel cell, direct electricity is generated and you can utilize, and it is the electricity generated simple and very easy. It is a DC electricity and you can utilize in any type of DC devices directly.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Actually, these features usually make MFCs very different from each other, like from other solutions. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your valuable knowledge. Our second speaker is actually ready. Now, Dr. Bhupendra Singh, sir, is actually working as a principal scientist and head at Center for Environment Science and Climate Resilient Agriculture, ICARI. He is also bearing the additional and responsibility of radiological safety officer at ICAR IARI, New Delhi since 2006. He has more than 25 years of research and teaching experience in area of neurophysiology and radiophysiology, moreover in phytoremediation of heavy metals and management of industrial waste. He has more than 90 research publications in reputed international and national journals. He has guided more than 13 PhD and MSc students and has several awards and recognitions to his credit, such as ICAR Lal Bahadur Shastri Young Scientist Award, DST Voicecast Fellowship in INSADAAG, International Scientific Exchange Fellowship, RD Asana Gold Medal, RH Dastur AAAS Awards. He has handled several research projects from DST, ICAR, BARC, Tata Steel Limited, Ministry of Steel, DBT, etc. Moreover, he is also a fellow of Indian Society of Plant Physiology and was elected Vice President for years 2014 to 2015. Thank you so much, sir. It is such a pleasure to have you. Over to you, sir.
Good morning, everyone there at Sharda University and all the faculty members, students and others who are joining this talk of mine today. I am going to talk to you about challenges and preparedness to manage climate change and radiological emergencies. I think the slides are visible to you all and I am audible. If that is so, I will be proceeding with my presentation. Now, let me just tell you what are the different environmental challenges that we face. We face why climate smart, I'm going to tell you. We need also agriculture to be pollutant smart because we are dealing with air pollutant, gaseous pollutants, heavy metal, a lot of waste. I think we have been hearing in this presentations over, from 13 to 17th. Crop residue management is another key problem that we are facing. Radiological studies are also required, waste mapping about industrial waste. E-waste is another problem. The major initiative on e-waste management, we need to look for adaptation and mitigation techniques. And also, in addition to all this, our efforts will not be sufficient if we do not deal into and get into capacity building and policy formation. And who else can be better than all of you who are listening to this? The challenges that we have in agriculture are, say, in addition to these environmental problems, are the variations in soil, multiplicity of the crops, different crop management practices, and also the situation is complexed by the presence of biotic and abiotic stresses. Now, this is, we all know the plants need nutrients and water for uptake, and I have a flow chart here which clearly says a better plant growth leads to a greater uptake of the elements, and a greater uptake of the elements leads to a better plant health. So it is, आप खाना खाएंगे तो आप अच्छे होंगे और अगर आप अच्छे हैं तो आप खाना खाएंगे. ये दोनों तरफ से, both sides this it goes, and we need to ensure that our plants get sufficient nutrients, otherwise we'll be going to have deficiencies. Now a plant needs a, but we need to understand is what are the interactive effects of these nutrients on each other. These interactive effects can be antagonistic and synergistic, and how they are playing under various cropping systems that we have. We have rice wheat, rice, cotton wheat, soybean wheat, maize wheat, pearl millet wheat, and systems that are coming, inter and interspecies variations are there. We have complexities of the agriculture system I have listed, I'm not going to spell out. But all these are likely to impact the nutrient transfer in the soil plants continuum. Now, why I'm saying this, you will realize when I'll be speaking, giving you about the other slides and other problems, because most of the elements, the pollutants that we have, apart from heavy metals, They are in the form of the GHGs. They are in the form of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen. Okay. So these can these be used? Sulfur, says SO2, SOx is there, NOx is there in the air. Can these be used as a new source of nutrient for the plants? Now, over the years, our carbon dioxide has increased, and it has increased tremendously or rapidly in the last couple of years. We have already reached 400 ppm. By the year 2100, we believe we'll be breaching 1000 ppm mark. Same is true for the temperature. We expect by 2100, year 2100, we'll be breaching from 1.8 to 4 degrees higher temperatures than what we have. And what kind of scenario we expect under those conditions? The regions that are cooler now will become more warmer, and the temperature, some of the crops which have a requirement of chilling requirement, those will be definitely in Himachal. If the temperature increases by 4 degrees, you can imagine the impact it is going to have on apple cultivation. And also the rainfall. Rainfall is like, you are in some areas you will have deficit of rainfall, while in others you have surplus of rainfall. So all this is likely to impact agriculture in a big way. Some cropping systems which we are following now in certain areas will become redundant after a while. We expect, as I said, we have already reached 400. We expect that by year 2050, we will reach 500 ppm. The temperatures by 2080, it is going to be higher by 3 to 5 degrees Celsius. We are going to have more of the intermittent and extreme heat stress conditions. The rainfall in the Kharif will be increasing, while in Rabi it may fall down. We have more rainfall days, and in other areas we will have more dry days. So the situation is going to be more unpredictable. And if it is unpredictable, you cannot plan well. So it is today we need to think of the tomorrow. All this, why we are as agriculturists, we bothered about the greenhouse effect or GHG emissions, because it is going to affect, cause global warming and affect various processes. I have listed here various processes, plant processes that are going to get affected and which are likely to cause the yield losses. Now, this is another slide, the leaf area index, leaf area duration, harvest index, sourcing relationship, all are likely to be negatively affected under the extreme GHG emission or global warming or climate change scenarios, and all of which are likely to reduce the grain yield. Now, our projected, we expect that by 2100, the cereal productivity will decrease by 10 to 40%. When I'm saying cereal productivity, it is that you need to change your pattern of cultivation also. See, you need to adapt to the changing climate. One of the way we can adapt to the changing climate is change the crop or the species. Okay, change the crop rotations. What are the crops we are following now? We may be like in Punjab now, most people, they are replacing, it is suggested to them to diversify, to leave rice in favor of sunflower. We are going to have extreme drought conditions and flood conditions, which are likely to have impact on the production. We are going to see more reduced frost damages. So some of the positive aspects are also mentioned. And you can see that not all crops will be affected negatively, but we believe that the C4 crops, maize, sorghum, they are likely to be positively affected. Now, when you talk about the C3 plants, which have, which have a lower CO2, higher CO2 requirement per se, because, or which are less carbon efficient as compared to C4 plants, because of the Rubisco and the reference of pep carboxylase in C4. We expect that the rise in the CO2 is going to have a positive effect in terms of the productivity owing to the increase in the CO2 level, the 25% increase we are expecting. But on the other hand, the increase in CO2 will be complemented by an increase in the temperature, which is going to reduce the yield by 20%. So overall gain under the climate change scenario for C3 crops is only going to be around 5%. And these are predictions. Some of this work, we are already doing it here under different conditions. We believe a lower temperature or a higher temperature under elevated CO2, the impact it is going to have on the yield in rice at higher CO2 levels, if the temperature is optimum, we are going to have a higher yield of rice as compared to the present ambient CO2 condition. However, when the temperature is rising, it does not really matter whether the CO2 is more or CO2 is ambient or less. This is again what I told to you all, that declining apple yields, and because of the unpredictable temperature conditions, and you are going to have a variation, drastic variation in the yields over different years. Now, Government of India has initiated several plans to adapt agriculture under the climate change scenario. National Action Plan is in place, and it covers not one but several initiatives. And National Mission on Sustainable Agriculture is one of them. But to act on it, we need to know how much, what is the contribution of different sectors to the climate change? What is the contribution of different agriculture ventures to the GHG emissions? And you can see the agriculture contributes about 28%. And the fossil fuels that are used in agriculture are also included in energy, which contributes about 61%. So major contribution in this, if you see the crop production, it is the rice cultivation, which is contributing about 23% of the methane. Whereas in other crops, it is the nitrous oxide, which is the major. Now at IARI, we have excellent facilities for climate change, be it phase feet or ozone studies. We have open top chambers, we have tunnels, we have all phenomic facility, we have phytotron facility, all the facilities that you would like to have for conducting this kind of study, the climate change studies, we have it. And we also lead in simulation studies. Our scientists, we are good at simulations also. Now what we are also, one of the tasks that we perform at IARI is to prepare inventory for the GHG emissions. And this is the baseline data for 2015, which we did it last year. And as you can see very clearly, the methane emissions, they have not changed, but the N2O, nitrous oxide emissions, they have changed. They have increased over the years. And this increase is coming because of the use of N fertilizers. Now, if N fertilizers is a contributor, what can be done to reduce we cannot reduce N. If you cannot reduce an application, what are the implications that you have? As I said, a good nutrition to the crop leads to good health, and a good health leads to more nutrient uptake. So when this kind of situation is there, you need to improve the N use efficiency, you need to reduce the leaching losses, you need to reduce the fixation or adsorption losses, you need to improve the soil organic carbon level of the soil, so that all the nutrients that are there in the soil are made available, because a higher SOC will enrich the soil of the microbial or the biological activity, which will improve the nutrient availability in the soil. Now, we did several experiments to indicate that use of biofilm, which is a mix of anabina and bradyrhizobium, it helps in improving the N fixation and uptake. So what our initiative is, can we increase the N use efficiency? Can we substitute N fertilizer with the different of the biological initiatives, biological strategies that we have? So we use the biofilm of anabina bradyrhizobium. We use integrated nutrient management. We use azolla. We use the limus, which is a urea stabilizer. Compare it with the neem-coated urea. Limus, it has a urease inhibitor inhibition activity, so it will not allow or it will reduce the decomposition of urea. So as a result, the availability of urea or the nitrogen to the plant, it will be synchronize with the requirement of the plant. Now we also try different modified urea's using phosphorus coating and different resin coating. We try azolla and how it can help in improving the use efficiency of nitrogen and reduce the GHG emissions from the soil. We also work on ozone and CO2 interaction. We have excellent facility, and what we found is that it affects the microbial community. We are also working on mitigation strategy. Use of ascorbic acid reduces the negative effect of ozone. And idea here is that we also, while we work on ozone over the years, we observed that it is important to study the interactive effect rather than ozone alone. So now we are focusing more on the interactive effects. Now it is also important, as I already mentioned, to increase the soil organic carbon. In the soil, you have only 5%, which is organic matter. And this 5% is very, very important. And you can very clearly see how the climate change is going to affect the soil health. And if that is going to different facets, how this the GHG emissions, how the soil health is going to affect the GHG emissions, and this is going to alter the water holding capacity, the nutrient availability, and in turn the productivity and health of the plants. Now it also affects the CO2, also affects the nutrient use efficiency. I took an example. Yes, please. Any question?
Sir, you can continue your speech.
There was some intervention, so I thought, okay.
Sorry.
Thank you. You have enhanced CO2, how it is affecting the nitrogen uptake and phosphorus uptake. You can very clearly see that phosphorus uptake is going to be higher by the crop under the elevated CO2 condition of 680 ppm rather than 340 ppm. This is an old study I included just to tell you that it is not the nutrient availability in the soil, but also uptake by the plants that is going to be affected, and which in turn will affect the dry matter accumulation or dry matter production of the crops and the yield. So can conservation agriculture or resource conservation technologies, RCT, which we commonly call, can they mitigate the GHG emissions? Yes, they can mitigate. And also second problem or point which comes is, can the conservation agriculture help in reducing the GHG emissions? Yes, it can if it is done properly. Now, different conventional RCT techniques over the conventional techniques are no-till, zero-till, laser leveling, mulching, leaf color chart. You have this mitigation using aerobic rise, direct seeded rise. This is the system of rise intensification. All these produce less methane as compared to the submerged rise condition. We have, this is very clearly shows that nitrous oxide and methane emissions are very high, extremely high under planted rice, but they get reduced drastically and more significantly under the direct seeded rice conditions. And we have the leaf color chart, we have the urea tablets, neem coated urea is there. We can use the nitrification inhibitor to have smart nitrogen management and to reduce the nitrous oxide emissions. Now we need to also understand our N application should synchronize with the demand of the plant. It has to be at the right time, right amount, right place, right measure, and right type. What is more important when we talk about conservation agriculture, it needs to promote carbon sequestration. We are going for mulching, we are going for zero till, we are going for addition of organic matter into the soil. All this is fine. But organic matter, if it is there, more of the organic matter means more of the CO2 will be generated, more of the methanation will be there. So this carbon that we add to the soil, it must be fixed. It should improve the organic carbon content of the soil to enrich the soil of the biological activity. Now what we do is we have conducted elaborate studies on the association of different, the soil organic carbon with different fractions and constituents of the soil, be it macro aggregates, micro aggregates, or different fractions which are there in the soil. And what our observations says is that the zero till definitely it helps in improving the soil organic carbon buildup in the soil. This is over 10 years, over 9 years, this data says, and it is against the conventional control. Now, water management is also critical. Raised bed, compared to the flooding, it drastically reduces the GHG emissions. Under aerobic rice, you have 39% less global warming as compared to the conventional rice cultivation. Drip irrigation further reduces it by 83% and 72% against the conventional and aerobic rice. So the water conservation also has to be complemented with other resource conservation technologies in order to get maximum gains. Now I go to the other area which I have included is the environmental pollution. Now we need to, our pollution loads in the environment are increasing. They are deteriorating our soil, water and air and affecting the human health and also the crop quality and also deteriorating the environmental sustainability. Now the area which I would like to talk about is the radiations in the environment. We are already having about 2.37 millisieverts of radiation, and after this, the Fukushima accident, and I think the Mayapuri accident that happened when the gamma chamber from the DU was sold to a scrapyard dealer, and he opened and there was an accident. After that, there was more awareness of the radiations in the environment, and BARC, B-A-R-C, and Department of Atomic Energy, they have initiated a program which is called IRMON. It is a Indian Environmental Radiation Monitoring Network. We are also part of that. And the radiations that are there, they are very low, nanogray per hour. This is the emissions that are there. And natural background radiation is 2.37 millisieverts. Now, we also contribute to this background radiation by nuclear fallouts are there, burning of coal, which is a fossil fuel. It is in the. It is also having anything which we extract from the earth matrix. It is likely to have some radioactivity. I think I showed here in this slide the terrestrial sources are also there. We have potassium, which is there in our all the ores and minerals. And we have the nuclear accidents that have happened in Chernobyl, in Fukushima. We have artificial radiation sources which we produce for our research purposes, X-ray machines and different cancer treatment and radiation therapies that are there. All these contribute, and should we worry about it? Yes, we should take precautions in radiological terms. There is a, we say always, we maintain that you need to maintain the distance, the duration, and I'm forgetting the third one. It is the distance, how that you should maintain maximum distance from the source. You should spend least time required in front of this one. And you should have protection. The third is shielding. You should have proper shielding, like alpha, it can be cut by a sheet of paper. Beta, the decay product, it can be cut by a sheet of perspex. Or gamma, you need a lead shield to cut it. And I just included this to show you that we need to worry about the ionizing radiations that are emitted from these radiological sources, because a P32, while it decays, it gets converted into S32. And if this P32 integrates with the DNA, it is likely to cause the mutations. These are the effects that have been visualized based on the radiation weighting factor and the tissue weighting factors. These limits have been prescribed. And when you talk about this, since this is going to have biological effects, the International Commission on Radiological Protection, it has established the operational limits for the radiation workers, which are 20 millisieverts for 5 years, per year, for a cumulative dose of 100 millisieverts for 5 years. And in any year, if you exceed from 20 millisieverts to 30 millisieverts, it is acceptable provided you maintain and follow the total limit of 100 millisieverts over the 5 years. It is similar to the guys who are working in Siachen, they are not allowed to stay there in Siachen for more time. After every 1 month or 15 days, they are bought back and replaced. So same are these effective limits are there. We need to ensure that work continues and also the health of the workers also is sustained. This is for general public, the doses are kept, the limits are kept 1 millisievert per year. What we can do is we can monitor ourselves using different dosimeters are there, personal dosimeters, thermoluminescent dosimeters. These are capable of reading alpha, beta and gamma exposures. Should we be worried? We should not be worried that much, but yes, we should be conscious of our surrounding. Already a lot of uranium has been detected in the drinking water. This is a geological origin uranium washed off by the rivers, meeting in the groundwater, mixing in the groundwater. It is leading to the uranium contamination of the drinking water. Already some of the this waste, the water treatment plants, they are established in Punjab, which are meant for removing this uranium. We also should be worried about the accidents that happen, nuclear accidents that happen, like this just the slide shows that how the activity from Fukushima moved the nuclear activity from Fukushima, the radionuclides contaminated the coastal regions of US, which are around more than 2000 miles away. And this is also, it moves in the environment. It moves in the environment. These are the routes that are how the radiation exposure can move in the environment, how it can get into the food chain. These are the limits, different nutrients and their half-life, different radionuclides and their half-lives, and the new standards that were established after the Fukushima in the food products, drinking water, what should be the limit? Milk limit should be 50 becquerel per kg. For general food, it should be 100. For infant food, it is kept at 50 becquerel per kg. Now, what is, so radioecology, we talk about interaction of the radioactive substances with nature, their migration mechanisms, uptake in the food chain, natural background radiation monitoring, that already we are doing it under the AMON program, and we should be conscious of our surroundings. We should be conscious of the radionuclide pollution. I think we had a lecture by a Bach scientist, and he said it is a dirty bomb. Dirty bomb means you are having it at one place. It is like corona. You don't know who is infected, who is not. If some activity is there in somebody's room and you are entering, you won't know, but you will be getting exposed. So we need to be very conscious. Of course, we don't, in research institutes, we don't deal with very high activity, but these kind of, this dirty bomb theory was told in case of some terrorist threat. So we need to safeguard our nuclear installations, nuclear sources, and the BRIT, the Board of Radiation Industrial Technology, it is maintaining in under the Department of Atomic Energy. It is responsible for maintaining the inventory and helping us in procurement and decommissioning of this through the AERB, Atomic Energy Regulatory Board. Different soil attributes, plant attributes, and also the input attributes, various factors, how they are going to affect the radionuclide movement. Now, we ourselves have done some studies. 1, 3, 4 adsorption, we found it to be 60% in ultisols and aridisols, whereas it was 98% in septisols. Further, the presence of potassium, ammonium, and oxalic acid. Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Yes, sir.
Okay. Potassium, ammonium, they are going to reduce higher radio cesium from the complexes. So it is not essentially the potassium alone or the analog element alone that is going to impact the radionuclide availability and uptake, but also the interaction of the analog element with other macro and micronutrient, which may have direct effect and indirect effect And working on this hypothesis, we found out that not only potassium, but calcium, sulfur, iron, and phosphorus, which have indirect effect or interaction with potassium, they are also likely to affect the cesium-134 availability and plant uptake and transport. Now, the another aspect which I would like to cover is the poor soil quality or the soil issues or the soil pollution. We have a lot of degraded soils. We have high acid level of acidic soils. More than 16 million hectare of our land is acidic, which can be treated. And when we say acidic or degraded soils, you have mentioned here that it is the pH of the soil that plays a very important role. It is the structure or the physicochemical properties of the soil that are important in influencing the availability of the nutrients to the plant. And in the very first slide, I mentioned that all of our efforts are to ensure that the plant takes up the nutrients and water in the right amount and does well. So when we talk about the air pollutants, not only the environmental pollution, it affects the agriculture, but the agriculture also causes a lot of environmental pollution, be it in the air, soil, or water. So we need to take care of this. So in our IARI, we are particularly working on the particulate matter, and also in particulate matter, we are working on the heavy metal association of the particulate matter, which comes from various sources. A lot of heavy metals have been detected in pastoral, vehicular, industrial, residential particles, the particles that are collected from various sources. So our effort is now to work on whether the urban cover, green cover, I think there was a connection problem.
Yes, sir, because of technological error, I think. No issues, please continue.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
You're audible, and your screen is also sharing to our participants' screen.
Okay. So I think, which slide did we miss? Did we see this? We all saw this slide?
Yes, sir.
Start with this particulate matter.
Okay. So what I was telling you all that we were working on particulate matter pollution in the environment, particularly the heavy metal association with the particulate matter, which comes from various sources. You have all the metals that are associated. We are working on the utilization of the green cover, how it can help in a higher deposition of the foliage, which are the crops that have a higher dust deposition or dust capturing capacity, and also not only having a higher dust capturing capacity, but also to allow a higher absorption and accumulation of these heavy metals in a manner that these tree cover, tree species or the green spaces, they act as a sink for the particulate matter associated heavy metals. Now we found, we worked on different species, and we find that they are associated with different metals. They are associated with the iron, followed by zinc, and various other heavy metals are also there. It all depends upon their dust capturing capacity, and the dust capturing capacity will depend upon the morphology of the foliar surfaces. How are the foliar surfaces? Whether they are rough, they are sticky, if they are having wax on their surface, whether they are providing some holding, some trichomes are there. And also they will be clogging the stomata, but for a tree species, we are working on that whether they will be helping in removing, not only capturing the dust. So we believe, I'll be coming to that, we did this experiment with the zinc 65 to show that not only these tree species, they capture the dust, but also allow the heavy metals that are associated with the dust to be absorbed by the plant species. As a result, now what we believe is that any dust particle that sits on the leaf surface will be relieved, if not completely, in part of the heavy metal load that is associated with that dust. And if later by rain, if that dust falls onto the ground, it will be mitigated of the heavy metal load. So we are also working on load. We are working on the gaseous pollutants. How you can see, this is exposed and unexposed. We have exposed it to sulfur dioxide. We are working on all the angles which are related to what are the various mechanisms that are operative. How the SO2 is taken up by the plant. How it is metabolized. What are the biological, biochemical and physiological changes that it is causing? What are the enzymes that are key enzymes, that is serine acetyl, serine transacetylase and O-acetyl serine thiolase, how these are helping in utilization of the SO2, and we have also worked on NO2, how these are allowing a plant to mitigate the SOx and NOx in the environment, and the plant is capable of utilizing it as a source as mineral nitrogen and sulfur. We are also working on the risk assessment of heavy metal contamination, and we find that the leafy vegetables, they have a higher load of heavy metals. And also, in addition to this, we are also working on strategies by which we can reduce the bioavailable heavy metals in the soil. Now, one of the key areas is the residue management or waste management. So this, we also at IARI, we have a task of maintaining and developing the inventory for the greenhouse, this one, the residue crop residue burning. And what we find is that this burning is there, but we are the legal issue or the law says now it should not be burned. So we are also working on how to utilize this for it, bioethanol production. That is one aspect is of it. Enzyme production of enzymes from these sources was another aspect of it. Converting into a nutrient-rich compost is another aspect of it. We have already developed the phosphorus-rich organic manures from this by using this composting, this crop residue management. We have also used the distillery press mud have the crop residue management, how to utilize different ways for developing bio-enriched compost using the distillery press mud. We are also working on waste to wealth for sustainable agriculture, and we are targeting the steel slag and the iron slag. We believe that can be a very good source. We are already having two projects running on this at our place, and we believe that these sources, the nutrients that are there in these, can be utilized for quenching or alleviating the widespread micronutrient and macronutrient deficiencies that we are having it in our soils, and also to cut the use of urea by half, if not half, at least we can attempt to reduce the consumption of urea by 2022 as advised by our Prime Minister. And we are transforming the waste into nutrient source. we are developing commercial viable innovative green technologies which will benefit both the industry as well as agriculture. However, a detailed phytotoxicity and the soil groundwater analysis would be recommended. Nothing which is in use of industrial waste is fine, but it should not be any lead to any toxicity of the environment. So all these things need to be studied before recommending anything. And in what form you would be recommending? We'll not be never be recommending anything raw. We'll be developing several products from it and then recommending. So I'll be coming to the last few slides. So it is imperative to follow balanced nutrition, integrated nutrient management, recycling of organic waste, site-specific nutrient management, customized fertilizer, organic farming for mitigating GHG emissions. We need to also understand what is the mitigation potential of different sectors, the conservation agriculture, soils, livestock, agroforestry, which we at IARI have not yet touched, but we would like to get into it. What policies and technology would encourage farmers to adopt? Because the resource conservation technologies are fine. They are given to the farmers, but at several places it has been seen that the farmers, after a few years, it again starts cultivating it. Instead of zero till, it again goes and plows the land. Now we need to, as far as the environmental pollution is concerned, we need to quantify the impact of the pollutants on the peri-urban and rural area, quantify the impact on agriculture, impacts of agriculture on the environment at the regional scale and then the farm scale, mitigation strategy, and also the economic assessment of mitigation. At the radial ecological front, we should find out the threshold for radiation tolerance of crops, dynamics of radionuclide transfer, biomarkers which can be utilized for assessing ionizing radiation in the environment, bioremediation strategies for radionuclide contaminated soils. We need to have data for feeding the prediction models for radiation productivity, impact assessment, and capacity building, as I said in my very first slide. And as far as the utilization of green cover for air pollution studies is concerned, we believe we need to plan the green belt in a more technical manner, considering both source and meteorological factors, which together would be determining the pollution fate within an urban area. We need to determine the threshold limit of SOx and NOx tolerance and in interaction with the different abiotic stresses. And waste to wealth is a reality, but requires caution, and say environmental implications need to be worked out cohesively and in depth. Before we, and thank you very much, guys, for giving me an opportunity to talk to you.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing such an grateful knowledge and to the speakers and as well as to us, to participants. We do have a lot of questions, but as you know, I can take only some of the questions. Should I start, sir?
Sure.
So I would like to start my ask my first question, that how non-symbiotic nitrogen fixing microbes reduce methane gas level?
The microbes, they play a role in reducing the methane emissions, because we have the microbes in the soil that will release methane, and we have the microbes in the soil that will reduce methane. So we need to have a consortia. I think this is very important. We have been talking about it, that bacterial crosstalk, we need to work out more how the presence, because when you talk about soil, it is not one microbe or two microbes. We have all the microbes which are required, which are having different functions, and they are performing their functions in complementation with each other. So it is very important that when we work out any strategy for reducing methane emissions, we work out in a cohesive manner what is happening to the nitrification bacteria, what is happening to the denitrification bacteria, what is happening to the methanotrophs, methanogens, and how we can reduce the methane emissions by increasing those which are able to, which are apt utilizers of this, your methane, you know, this we need to work out. Thank you.
Okay. So one of the participants has asked the question that in your view, what parameter should we include weather model for better rainfall distribution forecast? As we have seen, weather prediction model was not last year the climate change area.
My only reply to this would be that I am not a modeler.
Yes.
But I can definitely, in IARI, in my own division, we have people who are doing wonderful good work. We have developed the InfoCrop model. We have which predicts the yield forecasting of different crops. We have great meteorologists who are sitting in IARI. I would facilitate the person who has asked this question to come in, to be in touch with those guys and work out and improve her understanding or his understanding. But I am not the person who can reply to the question. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Okay. So according to you, do you think soil water assessment tool, a GIS watershed model, will help us for sustainable agriculture practice?
Yes, it will have help because already I mentioned that it is availability of water that is critical for your GHG emission, mitigating GHG emissions. We are still very far from our understanding how much Dr. Man Singh, I think he spoke to you all yesterday. Of course, his topic which he spoke on was flooding, but his main interest is on how we can, what are the various better water management techniques and how using the different modeling strategies we can emissions.
Okay. I think
Ravinder ji, I have one question with you, sir.
Bolie.
Sir, main Ashish Panda bol raha hu NDM se. Hello.
Ashish bolie.
Sir, I have heard that these radio isotopes are used for improving growth in the food and agriculture sector and for preservation, their storage, that length in the storage capacities, and also save the agriculture products from various diseases. If that is there, that is one question. And if these technologies are there, whether they are in the labs or they are being transferred to the land as well, to the local farmers. Hello.
Ashish. आप मुझे सवाल दोबारा करें, आपकी आवाज कट गई थी।
हाँ सर, मैंने सुना है कि रेडियो आइसोटोप्स आर यूज्ड फॉर ऑप्टिमम ग्रोथ इन द फूड एंड एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर एंड फॉर प्रिजर्वेशन ऑफ दिस एग्रीकल्चर आउटपुट्स एंड आल्सो सेव देम फ्रॉम वेरियस डिजीजेस। सो इफ दैट इज देयर, इट इज अवेलेबल इन द लैब्स ओनली और दीज आर बीइंग ट्रांसफर्ड टू द लैंड्स एज वेल फॉर द लोकल फार्मर्स बेनिफिट्स।
See, I had included a few slides on this, but because of the time constraints, I have later today morning I excluded them. You are right, we are using both radioisotopes and radiations, which itself is a big topic for discussion. And already radioisotopes we are not using for, we are using low dose radiation for increasing the crop growth and yield. Low dose irradiation, which we say harmless is radiation harmless effect. And also your concern about its use in the post harvest preservation, it is a reality. We have got about 18 gamma irradiators which are there in India, which are getting different commodities. The mangoes that we are exporting, they are radiated at 400 grays, the gray dose before they are exported. There are plants at Vashi, there are plants in Bangalore, in Sonipat, it is there. In IARI, we also have a gamma radiator, which is 5,000 cc. Of course, it's a research facility. And if someone brings large amount of samples, then we have to do it over time. 2-3 times you have to radiate. But we have our work also, we did a lot of work, how it will be inhibiting the sprouting, how it will increase the shelf life of different produce, how it can help in reducing even pesticide degradation, which is there. We have worked on that. And radioisotopes, we have used a lot on, I think, all my publications. If you look at, they are on radioisotopes and radiations. And we have worked on varied aspects of radioisotope and radiation use. There is another lecture which is going to come. I can share that with you. It is exclusively on radioisotopes and radiation applications in agriculture. And it will be on 22nd under the banner of Progressive Horticulture, which I would like you guys to also connect to. And you can get detailed information on that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Sir, I would like to conclude your session with the last question, that what is the remote sensing role in sustainable agricultural practice?
Beti, awaaz nahi aayi.
Okay. So should I?
Repeat the question, please. Repeat the question.
So what is the remote sensing role in the sustainable agricultural practice?
Remote sensing, again, I am not an expert in the area, but at IARI, we are working at length on how remote sensing can be used. And we are going, you know, by using this, not only the satellite data, but also the ground, vetting it with, validating it at the ground data, and also using drones, you can create, even now the techniques are there to identify different nutrient deficiencies in the soil.
Yes,
nutrient deficiencies in the soil, and it has a great potential. I think Dr. Ravinder Kaur, who is the next speaker, has also worked on some of these aspects, and she would be sharing some of these with you.
Okay. Sure, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for giving us your valuable time and your knowledge. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, Dr. Ravinder Kaur.
Thank you. Good morning.
I will disconnect now. Abhilasha, if it is fine.
Yes, sir. Kindly.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, sir. So, participants, Dr. Ravinder Kaur is our next speaker, who is Principal Scientist in Water Technology Center, Indian Agriculture Research Institute, New Delhi, India. She has 30 years of experience in soil science, environmental impact assessment tools, and decision support systems. She is a gold medalist in agricultural physics from country's premier agriculture research institute. She has developed many innovative methodologies for effective monitoring, management of soil water resources, like environmental impact assessment tools and decision support systems, for facilitating accurate impact assessment. Very recently, she developed eco-friendly wastewater treatment technology, namely Jalopchar TM. Moreover, the novel hyperspectral data processing techniques such as IMG2-Info and Rep2-Info, invented by Dr. Kaur, could be successfully used for the precise natural resource monitoring from both ground and satellite platforms. She has been honored with several prestigious national international awards, that is Young Scientist Award, Punjab Rao Deshmukh Women Agriculture Scientist Award, National Fellow position, and Fulbright and iHealth Fellowships. She is the Global Fellow of Robert B. Daughtry Water for Food Institute, University of Nebraska, Lincoln, USA, and Fellow of the National Environmental Science Academy, India. She is also the Regional Council Member of Global Partnership South Asia. Such a pleasure to have you, ma'am. We welcome you on the behalf of Sharda University and NITM. Thank you so much, ma'am. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Abhilasha. I don't know whether you guys are able to hear me. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Am I audible?
Clear.
Ma'am, you are audible. Anybody? And your screen is also being shared to our participants.
But you guys are not at all, just not audible. I could not listen to any of the presentations because the voice is not coming from a headset, but it is coming from a computer. and it's buzzing like anything. I don't know why. I've checked all the settings. So if I'll just scroll my slide, one or two slides. Just let me know whether you can see the change in screen.
It is coming, madam.
Yes, ma'am. We are.
You can. Okay. So as long as you guys can hear me, it's perfectly fine. But I'm wondering whether I'll be able to take your questions well or not. But I'll try my level best. In case I'm not able to hear you well, please text them and I'll answer all your questions. So with this, thank you very much for this opportunity to share and discuss, or rather I should say disseminate my developed wastewater treatment technology. And as you can see on the screen, the topic of my presentation is sustainable wastewater treatment for safe reuse in agriculture. So I'd like to first set the stage for, because it's a faculty development program, though I'm just assuming that the faculty would be the mature faculty. See, everybody knows that water is an essential element for our survival and also an important vehicle for economic development of any region or country or globe. I've been hearing many speakers since past few days, and I think by now all the speakers would be pretty much knowing that what are the basic major national challenges, major challenges confronting the country and the globe as a whole. There are estimates that to meet the food demand of the ever-growing population, the food production needs to be increased by 50% by 2025 or 2020 or 2050. So this means that if we need to increase the food production by 50% by 2025 or 2050, because different people are giving different estimates, that means that we need to also increase our water demand by a proportionate amount by 2050. But what we see today is a sharp decline in the per capita water availability. There are estimates that by 2050, our per capita water availability would be reduced by about 78%. So having this in the background, what we are seeing is that our food and water demand are increasing, but our per capita water availability is decreasing. But in spite of all that, if we look at the water as a complete resource, whether globally or especially with reference to the developing countries like India, water is the most wasted resource. We know that we are going in a stressful zone as far as water availability is concerned, but still water is the most wasted resource. Having said so, if we look at the statistics for the annual wastewater generation in our country, the current CPCB estimates show that annually we are producing about 62 billion liters per day of the sewage or the wastewaters, of which only 30% are actually being subjected to any treatment. Mind you, when I say they are being subjected, it doesn't mean that they are actually being treated. The actual treatment level is far lower than the 30%. So having said so, it becomes very clear that recycle and reuse of the treated wastewater, because the fresh waters are going to deplete like anything in the years to come. So we need to learn how to treat effectively and to reuse those treated waters for particularly the agricultural sector, because as we all know that of the total water use, agriculture sector is one sector which makes use of the highest proportion of the fresh water resources. So if this proportion can be allocated from the treated wastewater sector, then it can lead to an enormous savings in our freshwater resources. So what I mean to say is that recycle and reuse of treated wastewater has now become the most viable option. Now we have a number of wastewater treatment technologies available. Right in the morning, Dr. Abhilasha was also walking us through a very beautiful wastewater treatment technology. So, however, I'm not trying to criticize anybody's developed technology or to promote mine. So please don't misunderstand me. But it's a generalistic statement which I am giving. See, it has been observed that the conventional wastewater treatment technologies have so far proven to be very, very unsustainable technologies. And that's the reason why we are able to treat only, we are able to subject wastewaters to any sort of treatment by only 30%. Only 30% of the wastewater could be treated. Had the available technologies been sustainable, we would have already achieved more than 30% target by now, and we would have been just like any other developed country like Singapore, which is treating almost 90% of its wastewater and reusing it. But we are far away from that because the methods and the technology which we are using for treating wastewaters are highly unsustainable. Why they are unsustainable? Because firstly, they have very high energy demand, because even if you have to remove just the organic load in the water, you need at least 24/7 running aerators. So there is a high energy demand. So on one hand, we are saying that we are going down on waterfront. And as water and energy are like twins, they are like brothers, sisters, they go hand in hand. So if water is going down, how can energy can go up? If water goes down, energy is also going to go down. And if energy is going to go down, we just cannot afford highly energy intensive wastewater treatment technologies. Second reason for the unsustainability of the existing wastewater treatment technologies, which are commonly referred to as common effluent treatment plants or sewage treatment plants, is that they require a large amount of consumables, be it chemicals, be it energy, or be it bioinoculants. Right. Now, because they need excessive incorporation of the consumables, let's say chemicals and bioinoculants, so their incorporation requires highly skilled manpower for their operation. One of the participants has raised the hand, but I'll take the questions at the end of my session, if you don't mind, please. So, what I was saying is that the existing wastewater treatment, or which we call as conventional wastewater treatment technologies, are very demanding on the skilled manpower front as well, which is not so much existing in our country. Now, in the absence of the skilled manpower to operate these wastewater treatment plants, often the chemicals are applied in the wrong pH window, thereby reducing their pollutant reduction efficiencies. So the chemical, instead of reducing the pollution load, rather gets precipitated and adds further to the pollution load. So the end result is generation of enormous quantities of the sludge. And now, because our existing wastewaters are not like 100 years back wastewaters, which were only having organic and nutrient loads. Our country has long back entered into industrialization. And so there are a lot of colors around. When there are a lot of colors around, there are a lot of metals around. And when there are a lot of metals around, our wastewater is now not only having organic and nutrient load, but also many emerging contaminants like pesticides, like heavy metals, like antibiotics, and many more different sorts of emerging pollutants are there. So now what we are generating through our conventional wastewater treatment plants is a sludge, which is not good for any agricultural land application, but it is a hazardous sludge. It's like a bomb, which when applied on the agricultural land would definitely blast one day. I will enumerate it at the end of my lecture. What do I mean by this statement? So the end result is, because the existing wastewater treatment technologies are high on energy front, high on consumable front, high on skilled manpower front. Now, once we say skilled manpower, then they have to be also hired at much higher salaries. So the whole business therefore becomes extremely costly and therefore unsustainable. So we at Indian Agriculture Research Institute, we thought that why can't we develop such a system, such a wastewater treatment technology, which is sustainable in terms of its less energy intensivity, that is, it should be low on its energy demand, or maybe zero on the energy demand. It should be workable by any unskilled manpower also, and it should use minimum of the consumables, or maybe no consumables, and how to minimize the sludge generation from the systems. Because what is happening now is that you are treating the wastewater on one hand, but at the same time, you are also generating a mountain load of sludge. So you are getting rid of one problem, but one is creating another problem. So it has, and that problem is more disastrous because it has got all sorts of other pollutants other than organics and the nutrients in it. So with this, these researchable questions, we started developing a technology which we now call as Jalopchar. It is an eco-friendly wastewater treatment technology wherein we make use of the conjunctive treatment efficiencies of the plants. These are the vegetation, the native microorganisms, and the media. So it is basically based on special kinds of plants, which we call as hyperaccumulators, and the native microorganisms. Because you see, the wastewaters, they already have a number of microorganisms in them, but they are not able to perform their function, because in the wastewater, we have depleted oxygen levels. There are a lot of nutrients, but there is no oxygen. It's like, you know, stuffing a person in a room with zero oxygen level and feeding him with food. So if you have no oxygen, you would never like to eat any food also. As a result, the microorganisms are not able to function fully. Now, many of my colleagues will say there are many microorganisms which survive under anaerobic conditions also. See, but the whole process of treatment has to be done by a family of microorganisms. We don't need only anaerobes. We don't need only aerobes. We need a mixture, a combination of both, that is facultative microorganisms, to be more generalistic in my statement. So now we realize that wastewater is a resource. It has microorganisms in it. It has nutrients in it. The only problem in it is that there is no oxygen in it. And that's why you are in common effluent treatment plants or STPs, you keep aeration. You put aerators 24/7. So what we did is with whatever knowledge was available on ground, we tried to make use of that knowledge and develop. We started with a rural household model of 1500 liters per day capacity, whereby we tried to investigate the pollutant reduction efficiency of the planted systems versus, first of all, the unplanted systems. Because in literature, there was a lot of debate that the unplanted systems are equal to the planted systems. So we wanted to first of all investigate that the investigations which were done in the temperate conditions, do they hold in the tropical conditions also equally well or not? And when we found that no, the planted systems had tremendously higher pollutant reduction efficiencies than the unplanted system. The next question was, what should be that media on which, first of all, what should be those plants which we should be using in this system? So it's a very exhaustive R&D which has been done and it is still continuing. We are finding new research questions since 2009-10 till 2020. Now it has been past 11 years that we have evolved over this particular technology. So, well, I'll hold that all those messages for the later of my presentation. Otherwise, I'll get totally derailed from my presentation and I'll lose time. So what you are seeing on screen, it is a community scale wastewater treatment plant, which has been developed at the experimental farm area of the Indian Agriculture Research Institute. As you can see, it has a treatment capacity of about 2.2 million liters, that is 22 lakh liters of water it can treat in one day. And it works on the plant micro-media interaction. It has got three treatment cells, as you can see. These treatment cells, they are vegetated with a wetland plant called Typha latifolia. There are many other sites where we have developed these systems, and the selection of the plant is site-specific, the wastewater-specific, and the pollutant-specific. So I'll come to those details later. So as you can see, this is the quality of the wastewater which is being pumped into these systems. It can be gravity flow, it can be pumped. Again, it is a site-specific design. And this is the quality of the water which comes out after treatment. It is sparkling white water. We are using no 24/7 aerators in our system. We are not using any external bioinoculants or bacteria. We are not using any chemicals for our treatment. All what we are using is the solar radiation, the specific kinds of emergent macrophytes, which have got some economic value and which I will just show, and the media. So it's a lot of R&D was done on the type of the media also. So it's not just by ad hoc that we have selected the media. I'll talk more about the hydraulic retention time and the land area demand later during my presentation. So see, this is the satellite view of the system, how it used to look. How it used to look before the intervention. It was completely waterlogged, mosquito infested, and the Delhi Pollution Control was fining Indian Agriculture Research Institute like anything. And this is how the system, the area looks like now. These are the three treatment cells. And this is a tank which is collecting the treated water. And this treated water, as you can see here, this is a riser. This is regularly being pumped into the riser. And through the riser, it goes into the nearby, these are the various agricultural fields, experimental fields, which are using this treated water. So far, we have laid about 300 meters of the treated wastewater irrigation line in our experimental farm, which is capable of irrigating about 30 acres of our land area. So we are in this particular patch, we are not using our groundwater, which are being conserved now. So this is how the wastewater looks like, as I told, and this is how the treated water looks like. The irrigation treatment, irrigation potential of this facility is 132 hectares, but so far we are irrigating only 30 acres, which is about 12.5 hectares. So we have been monitoring the pollutant reduction efficiency of this system since its establishment in the year 2012 till 2020. We have been monitoring and we have found that the system has got exceptional treatment efficiency, particularly with respect to turbidity, which is 90 to 99%, it is being reduced. Pathogen load can be reduced by 99.8 to 99.9%. BOD by 78 to 88%, metals by 57 to 100%, depending upon which metal it is and how much of its concentration is there in the wastewater, nitrates and phosphates by 30 to 57%. We have now developed technology whereby we can further enhance the nitrate and phosphate reduction of this system more than the 60%. So, however, in this particular presentation, I'll not be going into all those details because time is limited. Now, what we did is we tried to investigate the, so all in all, what I wanted to say here is that this facility or the treatment has exceptional pollutant and pathogen load reduction efficiencies. Now, these waters we tried to apply on for continuously for 5 years on cereal-based crop rotations, that is paddy wheat crop rotation, followed by 5 years of round the year vegetable cultivation, as these are the basic crops which the farmers are trying to irrigate with the treated wastewaters or the wastewaters per se. And what we found is that although the application of the treated wastewater was associated with 9 to 18% reduced crop yields as compared to the wastewaters, and that's the reason why it is being highly recommended all over, that it's good to apply wastewater because it enhances yield, because it is rich in nutrients. But at the same time, we found that application of the wastewaters in the land also led to huge food metal contamination, which could be reduced by about 13 to 36% through continuous application of these treated waters. Also, continuous application of the treated waters led to also a tremendous decrease in the pathogen load in the food by about 68 to 73% as compared to the continuous application of the sewage waters. Now, if we compare our these results on the crop yields with the crop yields obtained through groundwater, then we found that though our crop yields with respect to sewage water were reduced by 9 to 18%, but these crop yields with the treated waters were about 1 to 12% higher than those obtained with the groundwater. Another thing which you can notice from this slide is that within 2 years, the consumer health hazard due to the contaminated food consumption, particularly the wheat and the paddy grains, it got reduced because these waters were earlier being applied in the contaminated soils also. Those soils which were receiving wastewaters for 50 long years, those were then shifted to the treated wastewater applications by us. So it took us time to cleanse the land also. Though the water was clean, but the media on which the crop was growing was already heavily contaminated. But continuous application for two to three years brought the consumer health hazard index. If it is more than one, it is hazardous. As you can see, that the food was contaminated even during the first year, even with the groundwater application or with the sewage water application or the treated water, because earlier this whole patch of land was being irrigated with only untreated wastewaters. We segregated the land into different plots and marked them as groundwater irrigated, sewage water irrigated, and treated water irrigated. So within 2 years, but the plots which were receiving, you see, these were all micro plots which were receiving the wastewater still had high consumer health hazard. Now we also tried to investigate the impact of these waters on the yield and pathogen heavy metal pathogen contamination and the yield of the fish in these treated waters. And what we found was that these treated waters were able to generate 40 tons per hectare of fish yield with less than 50% of the feed incorporation, because these were not chemically treated, therefore they had all the naturally available zooplankton and phytoplankton, which are artificially incorporated via feed in this system. So it is another cost reduction if you have practice aquaculture in such treated waters. Another thing which we found was that the fish which we got from these treated waters, they were having heavy metal load, very much within their permissible and safe limits, and also the pathogen loads were 99.5 log reduction in the pathogen load was also there, 99.9 or 99.8% reduction. Coliform count was found to be completely zero, nil in these fish. So it all this shows that it this particular technology is really not even able to treat the water, but also can lead to safe food production, be it the cereals, be it the vegetables, or be it the aquaculture or fish. So what are the benefits of this system? I would just like to summarize before you. The system, as I told you, it doesn't need any aerators, 24/7 running. So it has zero energy demand per se for any treatment. Now, why I'm writing zero to less than 0.3% energy demand? That less than 0.3% energy demand is only to if it is not a gravity-fed facility. Like the facility we have at IARA, there we have to pump out the sewage waters from the sewage well and incorporate them into the treatment cells. So this is that energy requirement, that is 0.3%. But per se for treatment, it requires zero energy still. In my another facility at Mathura, UP, which is there in the Pandit Deendayal Upadhyay Dham village, there the whole system is gravity fed. Even the ingress of the influent waters into the treatment cells from the village is gravity fed. So there, this energy requirement is further reduced. In the IRE facility, we need energy to put in the untreated waters into the treatment cells and to pull out the treated waters from the treated water tank and put them into the irrigation network of the IRE. So it is that 0.3 energy. But whatever the site may be, per se for treatment, the energy demand is zero. It requires zero chemicals, so it has zero chemical demand. It produces zero sludge, so we don't produce any mountain loads of sludges through this technology. And all this leads to the reduced capital expenditure. We have estimated that as per the 2012 cost index, the technology requires about only 55 to 65 lakh to treat 1 MLD of the 1 million liter per day of the wastewater. If I compare these figures with that of a base level conventional wastewater treatment technology, requires about 4 crores to treat 1 MLD of the wastewater. And if I compare this technology with another nature-based solution, which is very common, that is, say, phytoread technology or a reed bed technology, that those require about 1.2 crores to treat 1 MLD of the wastewater. Besides this, the operational expenditure associated with this technology is maximum 60 paisa per kiloliter. We have been successful in further reducing this OPEX to 30-35 paisa per kiloliter as well. Now, if I compare it with a base level conventional wastewater treatment technology, that costs us about 16 to 20 rupees per kiloliter of the operational expenditure. Besides this, why I call it as a sustainable wastewater treatment technology is that instead of requiring money for its maintenance and operation, this facility is actually able to generate economics, generate money. It's a business model integrated technology because, as you can see from this picture here, we have been harvesting these treatment systems since the beginning, since 2012, annually, about 3 to 4 times a year, and generate about 30 tons of dried biomass from 1.4 hectare facility. And we found that this 30 tons of biomass can be very easily be transformed into either particle boats, thereby generating a revenue of about 1.92 lakh, or it can also be transformed into the pellets and energy briquettes, also able to generate about 2 lakhs, about 1.92 lakhs per annum. So what the whatever money, little money also we are spending as operational expenditure, say 30 paisa per kiloliter or whatever, or 60 paisa, that is being compensated with more money flowing into, more resources flowing into through into the system through this particular. That's it. So you have reduced pollution load, you have money flowing through it, you have a good groundwater resource built, you have all environmental conditions intact. See, before particle board and briquettes and pellets, you won't cut any forest trees or other things, because this facility, if this facility is there, then it can easily be used for all, not only for treatment, but also for revenue generation, and the whole business can circle. There are many other benefits of this system. I'll come to that later. So we also try to analyze the ecological efficiency and sustainability of this system as in comparison to the conventional system. And for that, we applied, we generated the data and applied the data to various emergy indices, such as the ones which are mentioned here, like environmental load ratio, emergy yield ratio, renewable percentage, emergy sustainable index. And as you can see, the analysis showed that the implemented technology exerts 33 times lesser stress on the environment. As you can see here, the implemented technology was also found to be 70 times more efficient in utilizing purchased resources, right? And 25 times more renewable resource consumptive. That means it makes use of more of renewable resources than the non-renewable resources, which is very much required for any technology to be sustainable. In all nutshell, the implemented technology was found to be 1500 times more sustainable than the conventional wastewater treatment technology, as you can see here. Now, coming to replicability and scalability of this technology, as you can see that we started with a rural household model like this, which had a hydraulic retention time ranging from 14 to 15 hours, that is less than one day, and a land requirement of 2 square meters per kiloliter. And then we outscaled this technology once we were convinced that, yes, it works, to two different, to two more technological designs. And this is the one which I just enumerated in during my presentation. It's a 2.2 MLD system, and it's a horizontal subsurface flow design, and it is monocultured. It is vegetated with only one type of vegetation, has a hydraulic retention time of 1.53 and a land area demand of 6.45 square kilometer per kiloliter. Then we design another system which I call as combo rainwater harvesting and wastewater treatment system. This is an ideal system for any rain-fed area. So with minimal infrastructure, you can not only harvest the rain, but you can also treat the village-based sewage water and transform into 24/7 available treated good quality waters. And this is a 50,000 liter capacity system, which we have developed again in IRE in 2014. This has a vertical subsurface flow design, a hydraulic retention time of just one day, and a land demand of 2.25 square meter per kiloliter, right? Then over the time, now we have further expanded under the ICR funded, Niti Aayog funded CRP water platform. We developed another facility of 75,000 liter per day capacity. It also has a horizontal subsurface flow design, but it has, unlike the IRE, it has a mixed culture design. In IRE, we just had Taifa, but in our village system, we have to treat the high SAR saline waters, because this water is having exceptionally high salt content in it. So we had two different macrophytes incorporated into it. and it has a hydraulic retention time of less than again 2 days and a land demand of 12.16 because we had ample land available there. Then we developed another 50,000 liter capacity vertical subsurface flow system, which has a hydraulic retention time of just about 15 hours and a land demand of just 1.6 square meter per kiloliter. And this facility, as you can see, has been developed in our NGO. It is called All India Women's Conference in New Delhi, and it is fully functional since 2019. Another system under Swachhta Action Plan, a flagship program of Government of India, wherein Government of India has given us money to replicate our technology to 5 different sites in India. And one of these sites is Kazri, Jodhpur, Central Arid Zone Research Institute. This is a 1 lakh liter capacity system and with land demand of 7.35 square meter per kiloliter. Another 2 consultancies. This was also under consultancy, All India Women Conference. And then another one, another 2 consultancies were given to UP Jal Nigam in Kanchigram, Uttar Pradesh, and UP Jal Nigam in Palwal, Haryana. Sorry, this has got shifted a little bit. Both these are 1 lakh liter capacity systems and requiring 7.24 square meter per kiloliter. And additional consultancies in pipeline are 68 million liters a day system we are developing for Delhi Jal Board in Rohini Sector 26, which has a land demand of just 0.25 square meter per kiloliter, right? And another one of 4.5 lakh liters per day at Ghilot Industrial Area for a Maruti company. It is called Messrs. RK Overseas with a land demand of 2.5 square meter per kiloliter and 1.5 lakh liter facility in Haryana in our Krishi Vigyan Kendra Shikopur under Swachhta Action Plan. Another 1 lakh liter capacity system at Bangalore and Goa, again under Swachhta Action Plan. The one at Goa has a land demand of 1.2, and the one at Bangalore has land demand, and also at Haryana has a land demand of 1.5. Now, why I'm stressing on land demand is just to convince you that it is a myth. But many people say that nature-based solution or technologies like this are very much land intensive, and so we don't have land and we are tropical country, we are developing country, we should not go in for that. See, it's a myth. I've shown you the designs which I have developed and which are workable designs to as low as 0.25 square meter per kiloliter to as high as 12.16 square meter per kiloliter. So the technology is quite scalable, it is quite replicable, and if you have a very nicely designed system, one is able to rather conserve the land area demand by 177 to 332 times than the conventional wastewater treatment technologies. Why I'm saying conventional wastewater treatment technologies require more land area? Because when we calculate the land area, we only calculate in case of conventional technologies, the reactor required area. What about the office spaces where the skilled manpower has to be housed? What about the stores where you have to store the chemicals? What about the storage spaces for keeping the high-end filters and centrifuge rooms? So we don't add those up in the treatment land to be used for the treatment. And that's why it appears that the conventional wastewater treatment technologies require lesser area than such technologies. Now, this technology has been recommended widely by MOUD, Ministry of Urban Development, for extension to 420 plus Indian cities. And it has also been recommended for national level adoption and implementation by the Parliamentary Standing Committee of Agriculture. This is how our wastewater treatment facility at IRE looks like. This is a treated water tank, which you are seeing, and these are the treatment beds. The technology has also been selected as good practice under safe use of wastewater in agriculture by UN Waters, and also selected as a very viable technology by the National Steel Foundation of India, as you can see, an innovation in Indian agriculture. It fetched a Scotch Order of Merit award, two awards, on one after the another in the year 2017 as the top 30 transformational innovation projects in India, and also the Scotch Platinum Award. In fact, the DRDO technology was rated as lower than our technology. The DRDO technology got the gold and we got the Platinum Award in 2017. Now, just a little bit of a futuristic roadmap, and then I will end. This is my last slide. See, the current treatment capacity in the, if you look at the Ganga Basin, which is the largest basin producing maximum or the highest pollutant load. So the treatment capacity is 118 towns in the Ganga Basin. If you see, it is just 28%. And the volume which is yet to be treated is 2,609 MLD. Ashish can throw some more light on this, because during last presentations, he was giving some messages, sending some messages regarding additional treatment capacity which has been built by the government in the Ganga catchment or the elsewhere. So Ashish will interact more at the end of my presentation. Now, what I've been to say is that only 28% has been so far subjected to any treatment in the Ganga Basin. What is this pollutant reduction efficiency? I'm not questioning that, though it is questionable. And the volume which is yet to be treated is 2,609 MLD. And if you look at the BOD, and this treatment is through the conventional wastewater treatment technologies. Now, I forgot to mention, see, the conventional wastewater treatment technologies which are in place, they are able to take care of the organic load, and they are also able to take care partly of the nutrient load. But they are not able to take care of the heavy metal and emerging contaminant load so far, okay? So, but if you look at the BOD levels of the Ganga Basin, they range from 49 to 277. The question is, do we need such expensive conventional wastewater treatment technologies to take care of just the organic load? Because those technologies are able to so far handle only organic load, and that too at a very high cost. If we start to treat the whole pollution load of the Ganga Basin, we require about 10,436 crore money to treat, which is about 8 times more than what we would require through the proposed technology, right? So with this message and this thought, food for thought, I stop here. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. I look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing us with your knowledge. Actually, we got several questions, but because of shortage of time, I'm going to ask some of the questions. Should I ask, ma'am? Should I share the questions with you?
Madam, I'm not able to make out anything, whatever you are saying. I'm so sorry. I don't know what's the problem. Yesterday, I was on MS Teams and my microphone was working perfectly. But I can't hear you. Maybe you can hear me. So I will just guess the questions. Please feel free to ask me questions.
Okay, ma'am. Yes, sir.
हम ये questions यदि chat box में डाल दें,
हाँ जी sir.
तो ma'am शायद देख पाएंगे.
Okay, sure sir.
और copy paste कर दीजिए वहाँ पे.
हाँ जी, sure sir.
I can't hear. Kindly do one thing, madam. Since your course is going on for 5 days, you email me, take all the questions, email them to me. I will answer them, and I'll email back to you. Will that work?
Yes.
No issues, ma'am, then that we can do. Thank you so much.
So sorry. Or you can just send it in a chat box and I can speak. You can text your questions, whichever way, whatever amount of time you have. for this session. I leave it to you. Thank you so much, Dr. Gaur. Thank you so much. So, are you texting me the question? I will read the question for the benefit of everybody because you can hear me. Is there any increase in the concentration of heavy metals in the sediment of storage tank of treated and untreated water? See, we are not bothered about the concentration of heavy metals in the untreated water tank because all those we are going to treat through our technology. Now, as regards the concentration of heavy metals in the sediments of the storage tank, our storage tank doesn't contain any sediments. So, as I told you, we have done a lot of R&D. If you mean by storage tank, the tank where the treated water is stored, then sediments are zero. The only sediments which you have is through, because our storage tank is open to air and water. So whenever there is a squall or a wind, and the tank is surrounded with agricultural land, so during dry seasons, yes, some sand and soil gets into the water, but not because of the treatment. Okay, so that's not a problem at all. As far as the treatment beds are concerned, there we don't have any sediments. So my answer is no, no in both. Then is another question is, your innovations, can they be replicated elsewhere? I'll break the questions. Yes, I have shown you its replication potential at various places. Then how economical they are and how the local governments and municipalities can benefit from them. See, economics also, I told you, as far as the capital expenditure on having these systems in place is concerned, the cost with these systems is about 65 to 85% lower than the conventional wastewater system. So they are quite economical in terms of capex, and they're also very, very economical in terms of the operational expenditure. Because here you just need one unskilled person minimum or maximum two unskilled persons to take care of your system. They basically don't have to do anything much in the operations of this system, but only they would be handy to you during your annual harvesting plan, which we also give along with our consultancy. So maximum one or two person salary, and those are unskilled Mali grade people. So you can imagine how much money you are saving through this particular technology. So operational cost is just 30 paisa, 35 paisa to 60 paisa maximum. And about the local governments and they can benefit like this, because right now the municipalities are diverting the untreated wastewater as such in the agricultural field, right? Now, with the repeated use of those wastewaters, initially the farmer willingly takes because there is water scarcity. But over the time, he realizes that there is increased salinization in his agricultural land and decrease in his crop use. Then he stops taking it. And he says, "Nahi, ye mera zameen kharab kar raha. I don't want this water, even if you give it to me for free." But actually, many municipalities are charging the farmer for a polluted water. So what you are getting is death with after payment. So it can really help the municipalities in taking care of their wastewaters in a very economical manner, and also safeguard the environment and help the farmers produce safe food for all of us. Then is there any chance salty water can be treated for drinking purpose in the coastal areas within this technology? See, I belong to agri sector. My mandate is to generate good quality water for agriculture purposes. So I have been testing, and I can assure you that if you put this water, it can easily be used for, if you put it into the RO system in your household, you can easily drink this water because its quality is better than Jamuna water, which from where you are getting your daily water supplies. So, but it has got its religious implications. In our country, if you tell somebody it is wastewater, sewage water, isko pee lijiye, nobody will drink that water. But if you get water sourced from a contaminated source about which you are not aware and where all the sewage is going, then nothing happens in this country. So I will not like to answer this question fully. You can yourself answer this for yourself. But another half was that whether you can treat salty water. See, now we are in the process of treating saline water. As I told you, that the Mathura waters are high SAR saline waters with an electrical conductivity of 11 to 12, right? So those waters, we have been successful in reducing their salts so far by 30 to 35%, which is a very big jump. Because earlier we were only able to treat through this technology salts by reduce them by just 5 to 11-12%. Now with the new technology which we have been developing since past one plan period, 5 years, we have increased these pollution levels, I mean reduction levels, by 30-35%. So yes, you can, and we are still investigating on that part. How to reduce pollutants produced by factories at rural areas so that they don't affect fisheries? My answer is same. My whole presentation was on that. So do you agree with WHO that we need only 25 liters of drinking water for, WHO, that we need 25 liters of drinking water for food and hygiene, for rest of non-potable issues, water can be of lesser than, what is the question? Please be a little bit finer in your question, then it will be easy for me. 25 liters, forget about 25 liters. Recent statistics have shown that even 40 liters per capita per day, which we were thinking is sufficient for the rural area and the hygiene, has been under great controversy. And now people are saying it's 40 liters is not enough. And because you are giving only 40 liters per capita per day in the rural areas, therefore there is less of hygiene and more of disease in the village. So forget about 25 liters. I don't agree with that particular value. It's almost nothing. But if you are saying only for drinking purposes, okay, that's fine. Only for drinking purposes, it's fine. Any more questions? I think I have tried to answer as well.
Namaskar sir, namaskar Ashish ji, sir kindly, sir, kuch shabd kahe conclude kare sir third day ko. I wonder if Ravinder can hear me. Ah, bilkul sir, kahe bole sir. I am really glad that Ravinder very gladly, in fact, or very quickly agreed to my invitation. I was a bit hesitant, whether she has time to talk to us, but I'm really grateful that she agreed. First thing, secondly, I am really grateful for her contribution to the world, not only India, this contribution to the world, to humanity, the kind of wastewater that treatment has been done. I have been a witness to that, and also a partner to that work to some extent. The kind of zeal Professor Ravinder has, I have rarely seen in scientists, actually, and many others, you know. There are some people with great zeal. Abhilasha is one of them. She's another person who has a great zeal like her. And I'm sure they can work together. In fact, they can contribute much more. And their kind of work that they are doing is also quite similar. That's the reason when I took over as Dean of Sharda University, I first sent Abhilasha to Ravinder to see whether they can work together. Still, that has to happen. But I'm sure, in fact, I'm really glad that after my leaving IRI, Ravinder has gone far ahead, actually, and she has made so much of contribution in the same area. And far now, widespread to all over India, and in soon I think the world will take care of this, and the entire world will have replicates of the work that Ravinder is doing. A great lady, my congratulations, my compliments to you, madam. And I know, in fact, we have been colleagues for almost 30 years, at least I remember, and I have seen her, you know, very constantly working with great same zeal that she used to work as a young girl. And later on, as a scientist and being director of IRI also, and then director of WTC, she has continued that same zeal, actually, the same zeal of work to contribute to science, and that modesty still continues. She's very cooperative, and I am sure humanity is to gain from her. I congratulate, I wish you all the best, Ravinder, in your life, and I look forward to even greater contributions from you. Thank you very much. Thanks for giving this wonderful lecture. I have listened every word of it, and I feel I have gained some knowledge from this, even more than I had from you before. And in that way, in my around 1,500 participants who are right now listening to you, they have all been benefited. And I am sure they will all take this knowledge forward and replicate your things with your knowledge or without your knowledge. This knowledge is going to multiply. Thank you very much. Thanks indeed.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gaur. I could not hear any, could not make out anything, whatever you have said. Okay. But I must say that I must thank Dr. Gaur, because this facility which I showed at IARE was developed during his leadership, and there were many negative elements who were not allowing it to crop up, but it was only because of the strong helping hand of Dr. Gaur as an administrator that it could see the light of the day. So for that I can never forget, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, ma'am. With this, we will close the session after this talk. Hopefully, you all have enjoyed and gained a lot of knowledge from our eminent speakers. Kindly connect for the session for same time, that is 10 a.m. Kindly join 10 minutes before the meeting to avoid last-minute network crowd. I would also like to inform you all that 80% attendance is mandatory for getting e-certificates. Link for attendance and feedback will be shared further. Moreover, the time limit will be 6 p.m. till for filling the feedback and attendance form. Thank you so much.
Thank you.